Hello, thanks for joining us for our presentation on Manitoba's butterflies from the Living Prairie Museum. This presentation is catered towards adults and teachers that need a bit more information about butterflies, but if you've got a family at home that's keen on the topic or a classroom that's interested in learning, there should be a lot of information here for everybody. We're going to start out with some anatomy and biology. Then we're going to move on to discussing the families of butterflies that we can find in the province, and then we'll finish with information about creating butterfly habitat using native perennial species that we find in our region. So when we're talking about butterflies, we're talking about the order Lepidoptera. So if we break that word down and translate the two parts, we see that lepis means scaled and pteron means wing. In Canada, we have about 300 species, and in Manitoba, we have about 150 species. Now, according to the Manitoba Conservation Data Center, there are 141 regularly occurring species in the province, and that may change. The distinction here is that in some years we have butterflies that migrate into our province, but in some years not, so that can change numbers. These numbers can also change over time based on species losses, or they may increase due to range expansions, but at present we can say that there are 141 species that we could reliably locate in our province. So let's take a look at the anatomy of butterflies. All of our butterflies have the same basic body plan. Starting with the wings, we have a forewing and a hindwing. Both of these structures are attached to a middle body section here, which is called the thorax. And in the thorax, we have lots of muscles that are part of flight. And this is also where the six legs of the butterfly attach to the body. Up at the front there, we have the head of the butterfly, and on the head we have sensory structures such as the antennae and the palps as well. We have the eyes for the vision of the butterfly, and we also have that long feeding tube that's called the proboscis. And the proboscis is made up of two different mouth parts that actually come together to form this feeding channel that the butterfly uses to sip up nectar from flowers. Now, if we have a look at the tail end of the butterfly, we see the abdomen, and along the sides of the abdomen, we see little holes that are called spiracles. These are the little structures that the butterfly uses to breathe, so they're actually drawing air into those spiracles. They don't have a nose and a mouth and a set of lungs like we do. So if you see a butterfly sitting still and the abdomen's kind of pumping, that's the butterfly bringing air in and out of those spiracles. So the air travels through the opening into trachea, and trachea are tiny tubes that extend to come in contact with the tissues of the butterfly to allow them to deliver oxygen and remove carbon dioxide. So it's actually a very efficient way of breathing. Now we're also going to take a look at the wings, and wings are very important for the butterfly, so we'll spend a couple of slides on going through some of the finer details of these really amazing structures. So if we take a close look at the wing here, we could see how they get classified into that Lepidoptera group. Those are the tiny wing scales of a butterfly, and you can see they're in lots of colors that form that mosaic pattern that we see on the butterfly wing when we zoom out. To the right, we see a butterfly wing. That's the wing of a tiger swallowtail, and some of the scales have been scraped away so that we can see the structure underneath. And if we take a look at it, it's very similar to what we might see in something like a dragonfly or a fly. It's the same basic structure where you have a clear membrane and these rigid veins running through to help give that wing support. Now, wings provide a lot of different functions to the butterfly, and the one that you might be most familiar with is flight. So, wings allow butterflies to fly, which gives them an opportunity to go to different food sources, different locations, and even to avoid predators if they're being pursued. The other big function is thermal regulation. So this is the ability of the butterfly to regulate its body temperature. This is important because butterflies are ectothermic, which means they rely on the environmental temperatures to determine their own. So these little wings can act as solar panels, essentially, where they can open the wings toward the sunlight and utilize that heat to warm up their flight muscles, which is really important for helping the butterfly get moving, especially in the morning when things are quite cool. The wings are also involved in different forms of signaling. So the first one we'll talk about is warning coloration. So use the example of the monarch and the viceroy here. On the left we have the monarch, and you'll notice that the wings are very bright orange with a lot of white spotting, and that's pretty showy. And that's a way of telling the predator that might be hunting it that it tastes really terrible. So as you probably know, the monarch caterpillars feed on milkweed, and while they're doing that, they sequester a lot of pretty toxic stuff into their body tissues that persists on into adulthood. So if a predator feeds on the monarch butterfly, it gets really sick, and it remembers this color pattern as something to avoid. Now, if we look at the viceroy, you can see that it's evolved with a very similar color pattern. And when this occurs between two different species, it's called mimicry. The viceroy is protected from predators by looking like something like a monarch, which is the predators already know is really distasteful. But we know that the viceroys are also toxic in their own right. The caterpillars feed on willows, and so they sequester some pretty nasty stuff in their bodies, which makes them also very distasteful to a predator. So in this situation, you've got feedback between these two species with similar colors, really reinforcing the idea to predators that this color pattern is a warning and that you should stay away and not eat them. The next is not quite a signal, but it's camouflage. So if we're looking at this eastern comma butterfly, the surface of the wings is quite showy, but when the wings are closed, the butterfly is camouflaged to look like a dead leaf. So this isn't something that's very appetizing for a predator. If the butterfly holds really still, then it might be avoided. This last example is showing a type of signaling that involves startling a predator. So if we look at our northern pearly eye, we see markings called eye spots. It's thought that these eye spots scare a predator that's approaching. They might think that they're actually approaching another predator and then think twice about trying to feed on the butterfly. Another idea is that the eye spots focus the attention of the predator onto something that's like less essential, like a wing. They can handle a few snips here and there, but if the predator was to bite their thorax or their abdomen, that could be fatal. So next we'll talk about wing color. So as you know, color is usually determined by pigments, but in butterflies they have something else called structural color, where the actual shape of the surface of the scales determines the color that we see. So this is an example from a blue morpho butterfly. We don't have this butterfly in Manitoba, but it's often used as a study species in science. The wing is essentially brown, but if we zoom in on those blue wing scales, right down to 1 micrometer, which is 1/1000th of a millimeter, we see these interesting little structures on the surface of the scales that almost look like little pine trees. So those divots and undulations and kind of on the surface of those scales cause the light to behave differently. So when the light comes in, it's diffracted, it's bounced around, some of it's canceled, some of it's emphasized, and that determines which light wave we actually see reflected off of that scale. So we'll take a closer look at this next diagram here. We can see that white light coming from the sun, hitting those wing scales, and then it's bounced around and some of it's canceled out based on that surface structuring of the scale. And the light that's actually coming back at our eyes for our brain to perceive is that blue light. So the color that we're seeing is based on how the light behaves within those structures, creating structural color. Other animals can have this as well. A good example is the feathers of birds. You often see this on really highly metallic colors. So the common understanding of wings is that they were non-living structures. And there's been some new research to show that there are actually a lot of living tissues within the wings of butterflies. And these tissues can be really important in thermoregulation. So that's what we talked about earlier, that ability for the butterfly to regulate its body temperature. So they're finding living tissues in the wing veins and in these scent pads in males. And these scent pads are really important because they produce the pheromones that they use to communicate with their mates. So they're going to want to make sure that they're at a proper temperature so that they're functioning at the best they can. So these delicate areas require protection from overheating. And if we look at one of the images here, we can see that there are little veins running through it. And pumping through that is called a hemolymph, which is the fluid in the insect circulatory system. At the base of the scent pad here, they have these little areas called wing hearts, which pump to draw hemolymph through, which is going to help in the cooling of this area of the wing. And if we take a look down here, that pumping is sort of tidal, so there's an ebb and flow to the amount of hemolymph in there. These scent pads have been found to be cooler than the rest of the parts of the body, And the sensory structures in these areas, as well as along the wing veins, help the butterfly determine how hot it's getting and whether it should use behaviors to avoid the heat sources to help it stay cool. That's as much detail as I'll go into this. It's a really fascinating study, and there's a link at the end of the presentation if you'd like to learn more about these living tissues. Next, we'll talk about olfaction, which is the butterfly's ability to taste and to smell. So this is the ability to detect different types of chemicals in the environment. And I've divided these images up based on whether they're a moth or a butterfly, because not only are the antennae really important for olfaction, but they're also important for identifying whether you're looking at a moth or a butterfly. So on the left side, we have moths. They usually have two forms of antennae. One is called bipectinate, where the antenna almost looks like a big feather. And then underneath here, we have another form called filiform, which is like a long thread. And on these antennae, we're seeing over a million different little structures designed to detect chemical cues in the air, particularly pheromones that are produced by their mates over really long distances. Now, butterflies don't have the feathered or the long filiform antennae. They have a clubbed antenna. So this one antenna here, we can see the long segment and then the club at the end. And in skippers, which we'll talk about a little bit more, their club has a little hook on the end. So these help us distinguish between moths and butterflies. But the short story here is that in both groups, the antennae are very important in olfaction. Now, butterflies also have the ability to taste with their feet. They have sensory structures on the fifth tarsomere, which is a segment of the foot that allows them to taste the leaves that they're landing on. And this is really important because butterflies, as you may know, can be quite host specific. They need certain plants to lay their eggs on so that their caterpillars can feed. So this ability to taste with the feet helps them detect the certain species of plant that they're looking for. Butterflies also have the ability to hear, but it's not like an ear in the head like we have. It's a structure called a tympanum, which is essentially a stretched, thinned area of exoskeleton where sound hits that structure and shakes it, and nerves that are associated with it help that butterfly translate that into sounds. So it's kind of like the top of a drum, if you want to think of it that way. These auditory organs, which means an organ that helps them hear, can be found in different places of the body in insects, but in butterflies, it's typically near the thorax and the wing. So in this picture here of a butterfly, we have a structure circled called the Vogel's organ, which is the ear, essentially, in this butterfly. Now, the sensitivity of the tympanum to different frequencies might vary based on the predator that goes after that creature. So as an example, moths are very, very keyed in to bats in certain areas of the world where bats feed on moths primarily. And if you're preyed upon by birds, you might be more sensitive to picking up the sounds of birds. So it can vary in these different insect groups. Now, what do butterflies feed on? There's a few things that are very important for them. The first one is nectar. So nectar provides water and carbohydrates. They also feed on a little bit of pollen while they're nectar feeding, and pollen has protein in it. And they also need minerals and salts. And those minerals and salts aren't necessarily found in the nectar that they're feeding on. So they'll have a behavior that's called puddling, where they'll land near the edge of a puddle and they'll sip up the water that has all of the salts in it from the soil and minerals that are in the environment. They'll also do this on animal scat. So here we've got a picture of a gorgon checker spot at Living Prairie Museum feeding on the fluids that are found in animal scat, and those fluids will be very nutritious in terms of the salt and mineral content. Now we'll move on to understanding the life cycle of a butterfly. And I'm using the life cycle of a monarch because it's such a familiar species and it gives us an idea of how the life cycles of other butterflies might look. I'm also going to compare this to moths because there's some terminology that gets confused at the pupal stage, and we're going to talk about that. So this starts out as an egg, and that egg hatches into a small caterpillar. And that caterpillar is going to need to feed and grow. But insects that have exoskeletons, of course, can't just grow like we do and kind of stretch out. They need to molt. They need to shed that exoskeleton away so that they can expand their bodies. So this caterpillar will molt 5 times, and every time it goes through that stage, it's called an instar. So this insect has 5 instars in the larval stage, which is the caterpillar. At the end of those stages, it turns into a pupa, which is the chrysalis in butterflies. And this is where metamorphosis takes place, which we'll talk about a little more in a moment, where the tissues change to create the structures of the adult butterfly. So this is where a bit of that terminology gets hazy. In the butterfly, the pupal stage is called a chrysalis. It's an exposed structure that doesn't have any silk wrapped around it. But if we look at the moth, it's a very similar life cycle. You start from egg, go to a larva, which is the caterpillar, into the pupa, but here it's wrapped in silk. And when it's wrapped in silk, it gets called the cocoon. So that's when you use the term cocoon. In the moths, you have the silk wrapped pupa, and in the butterflies, it's exposed as the chrysalis. Now let's take a closer look at metamorphosis. So here again, we see the monarch butterfly as an example. In the first image, it has spun some silk on the underside of the leaf that it's going to be attached to. And silk is spun from the head around the mouth, not the tail end like you'd have in something like a spider. It hooks its little back feet onto that silk pad and hangs and sheds away the last layer of larval skin, so that bit of exoskeleton that was on the caterpillar. And if we take a look at that green structure, we can already see some of the forms of the adult there. We can see that underneath that skin, there is already the shape of the wing pads. This is the back of the thorax and the head, and then this is going to be the abdomen. And over time, this stretches out and solidifies to make this hard casing that's the chrysalis of the butterfly. There's some really amazing stuff that's going on inside that chrysalis. So the tissues of the butterfly, primarily the muscle tissues, are liquefying and being reformed into adult body structures. Not everything turns into a fluid. Their circulatory system and nervous system, and even parts of the gut, remain fairly intact so that the butterfly can still go on with its normal life processes in that form. But a lot of the other tissues are being rebuilt into these adult structures. Now, if we look at the end of metamorphosis in the monarch after about 14 days in the chrysalis, we can start to see the adult structures underneath. It pushes its way out of the chrysalis and hangs from underneath it in order to extend its wings. And what it's doing is it's pumping fluid into those wings to help them extend. And after a couple of hours, those wing veins are going to dry out and those wings will be rigid enough for the butterfly to take flight. All of the extra waste and extra fluid that was stored up in the body will be excreted as meconium. So it's sort of that rusty colored fluid that you see drip from the bottom of the butterfly. And this is just a closer look of a butterfly that had freshly emerged at Living Prairie Museum with those wings getting ready to extend. Next, we'll talk about this term brood. So a brood is a complete cycle from egg to adult, and depending on the species of butterfly that you are, you might have a different number of broods each season. If we look at the Polaris fritillary, which is an Arctic species, there may only be one brood every 2 years. It lives in a colder area up north where the growing seasons are very short, so it takes a little longer for it to go from egg to adult. If we look at the tiger swallowtail, this large butterfly only has one brood per year. And then if we look at the cabbage white, which is an introduced species of butterfly, it has three broods per season. So this one can go from egg to adult very quickly and very effectively each year, which is why this species can be a pretty significant agricultural pest. The monarch butterfly is pretty famous for having multiple broods during migration. So it's not the same butterfly that leaves Manitoba and returns again in the next season. There's multiple life cycles that are required for that migration to be complete. So if we look at this image here, the blue line represents the butterfly that left Manitoba at the end of summer and traveled all the way down to Mexico. Once it's completed overwintering, it starts to travel up north into the southern US and stops there to lay eggs and then dies. Its children continue the journey north. They mate, they lay eggs and die, and then their grandchildren continue on. So we get grandchildren and great-grandchildren that come back to Manitoba every year. All right, now let's take a look at the classification of butterflies. We have five families of butterflies in Manitoba, and I'll just take a quick look at each of these families individually. There are a lot of species, so of course I can't go through each one, but we'll get an idea of the types of diversity that we have in these families. First one we'll talk about is Hesperiidae. These are the skipper butterflies. Then we'll talk about Papilionidae, the swallowtails. We'll talk about Pieridae, the whites and the sulfurs. The Lycaenidae, which are the coppers, hair streaks, and blues. These can be very shiny metallic species. And Nymphalidae, probably the most diverse family that we have in Manitoba. These are the brush-footed butterflies. Let's start with the family Hesperiidae. These are the skipper butterflies. And these are typically pretty small butterflies. Most are usually a couple of centimeters in size. And in the case of the grass skippers, they have this neat shape that they take on when they're sitting still. They almost look like a little fighter jet. So we can see here that the forewing is upright and at 90 degrees to the hind wing. So they look like a little airplane when they're sitting still. We can also notice here that we have the clubbed antenna with the hook, which indicates that we're looking at a skipper. There are 36 species in Manitoba, and the larvae feed on different grasses and sedges. And when we're looking at skipper larvae, when you're trying to identify them, a lot of them are very, very small, and they usually have a very large and defined head capsule. So this is the head here. It usually looks kind of separate and almost distinct from the body. Skippers get their name because of their skipping flight. So they have a very quick, choppy flight where they'll land, then they'll take a little speedy burst and go to another location, and then another and another. So it looks like they're skipping along the grass. Next family is Lycaenidae. So these are the gossamer-winged butterflies, and that's referring to the delicate, shiny wings that they seem to have in this group. This includes butterflies like the harvester, the coppers, hair streaks, elfins, and blues. And in Manitoba, we have 27 species. I'm just showing a couple of the really unique ones here. This is the harvester butterfly. The larvae don't feed on plants, they actually feed on other insects. So this is the image of the harvester caterpillar feeding on its favorite food, which are woolly aphids. So this is actually a carnivorous caterpillar. This is another example here. This is a silvery blue butterfly, and I'm sure you've seen this species in springtime fluttering around your shoes. The caterpillar is somewhat slug-like, and it can be green or pink as we see here, and they typically feed on vetches and pea vines. What's really neat about these caterpillars is that they're attended by ants, so they actually secrete honeydew from a gland on their body that feeds the ants and entices them to hang around them and protect them, so it keeps them safe from predators. The next family is Pieridae. These are the whites, marbles, and sulfurs, and there's 16 species in Manitoba. They often feed on legumes, so again, that sort of pea family of plants. One of the ones I'm showing here is the cabbage white. Now, this butterfly was introduced into Canada from Europe in about 1860. It's a very prolific species, as we saw with the number of birds per year, and it can be found pretty much everywhere in the world where there's agriculture. If we take a close look here, we see that the male butterfly has one spot on the wing and the female has two. This is another example of a common sulfur. This is the clouded sulfur, and it's the yellow form here. And this species also has white forms, so sometimes they don't have any of that yellow scaling. It's all white. And you might confuse the two here, but you'll note that the front spot is close to the leading margin of the wing, and it's very defined. And they also have this very defined black edging around the entirety of the wing, which you don't really see in that cabbage white. This is the family Papilionidae. These are the swallowtail butterflies. They're really large and showy. We just have the three regularly occurring species in Manitoba, one of which is the Old World swallowtail here. The one you might be likely to see is the Canadian tiger swallowtail. What's neat about these is that the larvae have eye spots on the front of the body there, so it almost makes them look like a little snake or some kind of predator that might scare away other predators trying to feed on it. They like to feed on a variety of trees, including ash and poplar, so you may very well see these. This is the one that's the most common in Winnipeg here, and you've likely to have encountered this species in your garden. This is the black swallowtail. The larvae commonly feed on things in the carrot family, so you've probably seen them on your carrots or your parsley or your dill in your garden. The native plant that they feed on is in the genus Zizia, so they'll feed on Zizia aptera and Zizia aurea. So something that's a neat feature about all of these swallowtail caterpillars is that they have this little structure that will pop out just behind the head if you disturb them. So if you give them a little tap and they think you're a predator, they'll expose this organ called the osmeterium, and it has really stinky, smelly stuff on there, and it would make the predator taste something really terrible and make them really smelly. So it's a deterrent that keeps them safe. Now, something to note about the black swallowtail caterpillar is it's often confused with the monarch caterpillar. Now, black swallowtails are in the family Papilionidae. Monarchs are in a different family called Nymphalidae, which we'll talk about in a moment. But if we compare the two side by side, you can see that the black swallowtail has black striping with yellow spots worked in, and it doesn't have those long tentacles on the fore and hind end. The chrysalis is also very different. So in the black swallowtail, it can look like a brown dead leaf, or sometimes it's more greenish, and it's attached to the plant. And this species can have multiple broods in a season, but it will overwinter in the chrysalis stage. In our monarch, we see this nice bright green chrysalis with the gold edging here, and of course, we're not going to see this overwintering. There's going to be the migratory generation that leaves. The last family we'll look at is family Nymphalidae. These are the brush-footed butterflies. This includes things like fritillaries, checker spots, angle wings, and thistle butterflies, which are painted ladies. And there's 59 species that are found in Manitoba. They're very diverse in their appearance, their host plants, their survival strategies. So if you want to know something about a particular species in this family, you basically have to read up on them individually to know things like what they like to eat and how they overwinter. Note that only four legs are visible when butterflies are perching in this family. So we know that insects have six legs, so where are those other two? Well, if we look at this picture of our red admiral, we see the mid legs and the hind legs. And the fore legs are actually very reduced and tucked up and held against the thorax. So the thought is that these reduced legs are important for sensing the environment. They have the structures called setae that are used in taste and smell, so this may better help the butterfly perceive its environment and perhaps communicate with mates and detect its host plant. These are just a few examples of some of the species in this family. We have on the left the mourning cloak, and you'll often see this species in springtime because the adults overwinter. The larva is pictured below. They're very spiny, and sometimes I think they're called elm caterpillars. They'll feed on elm trees and can be pretty numerous in some seasons to the point where they're almost considered a pest. We have painted ladies in this group. Painted ladies are well known for really big migrations into Manitoba if the host plants and conditions are doing really well in the States. So some years we see lots of these butterflies. The eastern comma, this group, they're often named based on the shape of this little white marking, which kind of looks like a punctuation mark. And then lastly, of course, we have the monarch butterflies, which we talked about earlier in the group Nymphalidae. So now that we've learned about all of these butterflies, you might want to know how you can attract them to your yard and how you can help them survive in the wild. So there's a few tips that we have here for you in terms of the types of host plants that you should be planting. The first word of advice is to always conserve the habitat that we have that's intact. Because as much as we want to try to recreate natural habitat, it's extremely difficult to mimic what's happened in nature. So if there's an area of pristine habitat, and in Winnipeg we have lots of spaces of tall grass prairie and river bottom forest and aspen and oak forest, you want to try to leave those in one piece where these butterflies can complete their life cycle naturally. When this isn't a good option, as we know, development happens. What we can try to do to mediate that habitat loss is to naturalize, and that's where we try to create natural habitat using the species that are normally found within this area, so endemic to our province. And this is something that you can do in your backyards on a pretty small scale, but still support a lot of different species of insect, particularly butterflies. As was mentioned briefly earlier, a lot of caterpillars are very specialized, which means that they have a very narrow window of species that they'll actually feed on. So they're host specific in many cases. And if they don't have the appropriate native host, they won't be able to complete their life cycle. So I just have a few examples here. Of course, we know that the monarch caterpillar only feeds on plants in the milkweed group. So we have seven species of milkweed in Manitoba, and they'll feed on all of those different species. But they won't feed on anything else. So if you don't have milkweed present, the monarch won't be able to complete its life cycle. This is just an example of the Gorgon checker spot that we saw earlier feeding on the scat. Their caterpillars feed on prairie sunflowers. And these are the native prairie sunflowers, not the type of sunflower that you find in an agricultural field. And lastly, here we have a butterfly that you probably won't encounter called the Powashiek skipperling. It's only found in a very small range in southern Manitoba in the Tallgrass Prairie Preserve, and it's the only population that we have in all of Canada. It's a Tallgrass Prairie obligate species, which means it's found in no other habitat. And the caterpillars need prairie drop seed primarily in Manitoba to feed on, and the adults prefer to take nectar from black-eyed Susans. So the caterpillars are pretty specific, and the adults seem to be as well. So this slide is just trying to emphasize the fact that you really need native species to help these insects out. And native perennial prairie species are great to plant at home. They're adapted to our local conditions. You don't have to plant them every year. They're a host plant for a lot of our insects, and once they're established, they're really drought tolerant. So they're a pretty good garden plant, and there's certain species that are pretty useful in the garden and pretty beautiful. When you compare them to a non-native annual, they might not be as hardy. They probably aren't going to be an appropriate host to most of our species. They need replanting every year and more watering and maintenance. So if you're looking for a long-term garden that supports native species of insects in the best way possible, you're looking at choosing native perennials whenever you can, or at least mixing them into your current plantings with your annuals. So I'll go through a list of some species that you can find at local native growers that support butterflies by being host plants for their caterpillars. So the first one we'll start with are violets, and there's several species of violet. One that you can commonly find at native growers are the early blue violet, Viola adunca, and violets are the host plants for fritillary butterflies. So as an example here, I have the great spangled fritillary. The next plants are heart-leaved or golden alexanders. These are host plants for the black swallowtail caterpillars that we spoke about earlier. So if you can find Zizia aptera or Zizia aurea, these are great hosts. But of course, these butterflies aren't quite so picky, so they'll feed on your dill and your carrots as well. So if you're planting a veggie garden, you can always leave a few left behind for them. Swamp milkweed. Now, as I mentioned, there's seven species in Manitoba, but we're singling this one out in particular because it's a fairly well-behaved milkweed for urban planting. The leaves are, of course, hosts for the caterpillars of monarchs, and it provides a lot of nectar to other pollinators through these beautiful pinkish-purple flowers that it produces. Now, the nice thing about swamp milkweed is that it's a clump-forming species, so where you plant it, it'll stay. It won't spread by rhizome. And it gets to be a nice kind of shrubby 1 meter tall plant. If you don't want it to spread by seeds, you can always harvest those seed pods once they've developed. The next little plant is called pussy toes. These are Antenaria parvifolia. I think there's a couple of species produced by native growers. They are really short and close to the ground, so they make great ground cover if you need some edging in your garden. They seem to be host to both American painted ladies and painted lady caterpillars. And the next species as well, they seem to be interchangeable hosts for these butterflies. This is the caterpillar of the American painted lady, and this is the adult. And if you'll notice in the American painted lady, there are just two eye spots on the underside of the hindwing. In the painted lady, there are several eye spots along that edge. So here's the other host plant. This is Pearly Everlasting. And this plant we've seen both the American and painted ladies feeding on it. And the caterpillars create almost like a little rolled up leaf nest with silk while they're feeding. So here we have the image of the painted lady caterpillar for comparison with the previous slide, and then the adult as well. Pearly Everlasting is a plant that has really nice, soft, fuzzy leaves, and it ends up forming almost like a little shrubby plant in your garden. And this last species we'll show is New England aster. It's a really beautiful type of native aster that almost forms like a thick, dense group of flowering stems. They can be dark purple to light purple, and it flowers pretty late in the season, so it can be an important source of nectar for pollinators getting ready to overwinter or migrate in the fall. It's a host plant for crescent butterflies, and I should note that crescent butterflies will feed on a variety of asters, so this is just one example. Pictured below is the northern crescent, and then there's a caterpillar of another crescent species, which looks quite similar, just to give you an idea of what the caterpillar might look like. Asters in general are a great addition to your native garden for butterflies and for other pollinators, so there's just a few examples here. Plant lots of asters. You're going to be supporting a lot of different types of beneficial insects if you have these plants available to provide pollen and nectar. There are also some great options in the mint and legume family here, things like bergamot, which is also sometimes called bee balm. They've got long flowers with long nectar tubes that are great for butterflies and even hummingbirds. Giant hyssop, the prairie clovers, and wild pea vine, they're all great additions to your garden. When you group all these plants together into a naturalized planting, you end up with a really beautiful, diverse butterfly garden that can support a variety of species, and you'll get a lot of butterflies attracted to it, as well as bees and flies and beetles and lots of other really fascinating insects. What you're doing here is essentially thinking of this planting as a little ecosystem. You're providing shelter, you're providing food, you're providing overwintering habitat to a variety of different species in an urban area that may not have them otherwise. This slide is showing some of the species that might benefit from a garden like this. So the first image is a dragonfly, and they may use this space as a hunting ground for a variety of insects, including ones that we find to be pest species like mosquitoes. Below it is a green lacewing, and the larvae of the green lacewing are important predators of soft-bodied insects that we find to be pests in our veggie gardens. The goldfinch represents migratory birds, so this planting is going to produce a lot of native seed that these birds are going to use to feed on while they're getting ready to leave for the winter. The last image is of a frog, so the damp understory and the protection from all of the leaves might be great for an amphibian that needs a place to shelter. If you'd like to learn more about pollinator conservation, we helped create a website called Be Better Manitoba. So Be Better Manitoba is a group of like-minded organizations who came together with this common goal of inspiring Manitobans to create pollinator-friendly habitat. So the website includes a lot of information that you might be interested in. It goes into some pollinator biology and some of the reasons why they're declining, the habitat needs that they have, some planting guides, including lists of native flowering species, and some information that's pretty specific to homes, schools, and businesses. There's also a page with a lot of extra resources if you want to do further reading. If you'd like to get involved in the Be Better Challenge, you can post the photos of the habitat that you're creating on Instagram with the hashtag so that other people can share in what you're doing. Thanks very much for taking part in our presentation today. I hope you learned something interesting and useful about butterflies. If you have further questions and you just want to get in touch, there's our contact information for the Living Prairie Museum. Following this slide, I have a couple of slides with extra resources. So if you want to go forward into this part of the video and maybe pause it, you can take a look at the different links that we have here. And this is just expanding on some of the information that I provided in the presentation. And on the last slide here, I have some recommendations for insect guides. So if you want to find field guides to take with you, or just really good general reading about insects, these are some great resources. So again, thank you very much, and I hope you have a lot of fun looking at butterflies this year.